So, welcome everybody. My name is Pavel Pols. I'm a member of European Parliament from Czech Republic, member of Socialist Group, and I'm vice chair of the Environment Committee. I'm very happy to host this, this event because I think that we are facing, or we will be facing, a discussion about the drying disruptors and the criteria and proposal of the Commission. So thank you for coming today and for joining us for an expert discussion on the Commission proposal for the drying disruptors criteria. The two proposals concerning plant protection products and biocides presented on 15 June this year started quite a heated debate, and I would gladly leave the comments on the substance of the proposal to the experts and today's distinguished speakers from Endocrine Society, Clyde Earth, and Swedish Chemical Agency. Let me, however, touch two crucial aspects of the proposal before first giving the floor to Angeliki Lissimaku from Pesticide Action Network Europe, my, if I may, long-term partner in the field of chemical legislation and protection of human health, with whom I'm happy to organize this event. The first thing I would like to make absolutely clear is the scope of the criteria. The 7th Environmental Action Plan asks explicitly for horizontal criteria that could be applicable not only in the remits of biocides and plant protection products, but also to Water Framework Directive, cosmetic regulation, and other relevant pieces of legislation. Secondly, and here I echo somehow the concerns from some member states, I guess it's 15 of member states to this date, the fact that the Commission decided to require an unprecedented and scientifically very hardly justified level of evidence for identification of endocrine disrupting properties that is moreover inconsistent with the corresponding legislation and which in general lacks a precautionary principle is not acceptable. I'm sure we will hear more on the topic of presumed endocrine disruptors later during the presentations. Let me here just highlight the importance that the co-legislators ascribe to substances only presumed to have cancerogenic, mutagenic, or reprotoxic properties. In this respect, of all category 1 carcinogens listed on Annex 6 CLP on harmonized classification labeling of hazardous substances, about 75% are in category 1B. Likewise, about 75% of all listed category 1 reprotoxicants belong to category 1B, presumed. With respect to mutagenic substances, all 100% category 1 representatives listed from Annex 6 belong to category 1B, presumed. I'm convinced the same principles should be applied also to endocrine disruptors and consider this as one of the crucial shortcomings of the Commission proposal. Since according to the agenda, I have virtually no time, if you look at the program, I have virtually no time for this introduction. Let me know fast operating to Angeliki so we can start with the expert presentation. Angeliki, the floor is yours.
Okay, on the behalf of Pesticide Action Network Europe, I also want to welcome you all here today. I hope we'll have a good discussion. We're first going to present the legal and scientific aspects of the Commission's proposal on EDC criteria, and I hope we have a very good discussion afterwards. I want to thank MEP Robert Koch for hosting this event and also his assistants for the great help. But also for the important work he's doing in order to provide a higher level of health standards for us, the Europeans, and the environment we live in. Then I would like to thank the speakers for accepting to come here today and present the work on endocrine disruptors, and also for participating in the discussion. And finally, let me just introduce you to my organization, Pesticide Action Network Europe. is the regional European office of a global organization of more than 600 NGOs that they want to replace hazardous pesticides with ecologically friendly alternatives. About the EDC, scientists have been warning us for decades that some chemicals, previously thought to be harmless to humans, they're not that innocent after all. Evidence of endocrine disruption following chemical exposure, sometimes just to low environmental concentrations, is observed in wildlife, in laboratory animals, but also in humans. In European population, endocrine-related diseases such as breast, testicular, and prostate cancers are on the rise. The same is observed for endocrine-related disorders such as reproductive failure, infertility, early puberty, neurodevelopmental and behavioral disorders. In fact, the more we learn about the endocrine system of humans, the more adverse effects we detect from exposure to chemicals and the known health costs are multiplied. In a preliminary study, one year we had detected 30 pesticides with EDC properties that may cause adverse health to humans. Similarly, in a recent screening of pesticides by the Commission, in a methodology from Joint Research Center, out of 300 pesticides screened, 26 were classified as presumed endocrine disruptors and 82 as suspected. This is very worrying if we consider that 95 of the European agricultural land is treated with pesticides. These are detected not just in nature and its ecosystem, but also in our home, our gardens, our food, our bodies, and those of our children. Almost 50% of the food contains at least one pesticide. Some may contain up to 16 or 18. Neither endocrine disrupting pesticides nor mixture are currently regulated and they may be causing harm. The pesticide regulation that entered into force in 2011 recognizes that pesticide use may involve risk and hazards for humans, as well as animals in the environment. Aiming at providing a high level of protection, the regulation calls to apply the precautionary principle and ban hazardous pesticides from use in agriculture. This includes mutagens, carcinogens, toxic to reproduction, and endocrine disrupting chemicals. The same is true for biocides. This will push us to develop further the alternative practices in agriculture and don't incorporate the use of toxic substances. After all, pesticides have made massive food production cheaper in economic terms, but not without a health and environmental cost. We need alternatives. One example is the integrated pest management included in the Sustainable Use of Pesticide Directive, which indicates the use of pesticides as a last resource in agriculture and proposes several non-chemical practices that can be used instead. Unfortunately, this directly is still poorly implemented in member states. One element that was missing from the regulation was a set of criteria to identify which pesticides or biocides are EDCs. Following a prolonged delay, the Commission published a set of EDC criteria only in June 2016, 2.5 years past its deadline. Several events happened in this period of delay. Intense lobbying from pesticide industry and trade sector, a set of scientific criteria that never got published, a European Court of Justice decision that the Commission had breached the law by not presenting the criteria, we will hear more about this from my Swedish colleague, and a socioeconomic impact assessment on different EDC criteria options that was not in the provisions of the pesticide regulation. As we will see today, this set of criteria received strong criticism by scientists, member states, lawyers, and the civil society organizations that would fail to capture enough EDCs, if any, leaving Europeans and environment unprotected from these substances. We are at a crucial moment in Europe to finalize this criteria to regulate the EDCs. The decisions that regulators and member states make today will determine the level of protection, not just for us and our children, but also for the future generations. We hope with this meeting to resolve some questions and uncertainties behind the proposed decision criteria and the data the main body and help regulators in their decision. And now we'd like to give the floor to our first speaker, Jean-Pierre Bourguignon. He's an emeritus professor of pediatrics at the University of Liège, and his main research interests are neuroendocrine mechanisms of puberty and neuroendocrine disruption. He's the author of more than 200 peer-reviewed articles. Professor Bourguignon is co-chairing Endocrine Society Policy Task Forces on Endocrine Disruptors, and he was awarded this year the Outstanding Public Service Award of the Endocrine Society. With more than 18,000 members, from more than 120 countries around the world, the Endocrine Society is the biggest scientific organization committed to excellence in endocrine science and care of patients with endocrine diseases.
Good afternoon. Thank you for the introduction and the invitation to this meeting. So. So what I wish to do is to look from a scientific perspective about the recent EC proposal for EDC identification criteria and tell you where we as scientists can see some questions and some problematic issues. And as you know, basically, five documents have been released, a communication document, two draft law for pesticide and biocide, and an impact assessment study. And I will basically quote some part of those documents and explain where there are some possible issues. The first, quite trivial for a scientist, is to discuss how will scientific data be evaluated. And scientific data should be, according to this proposal, should be standardized for protocols and reviewed retrospectively by non-peers. As it reads in the proposal, it is that identification of endocrine disruptor is based on all available relevant scientific evidence, primarily performed according to internationally agreed study protocols. But this, of course, makes much sense as a regulator for procedure, for authorization of some products. I understand that. But as a scientist, I need to individualize my protocols for ends. And if those individualized protocols studies are not going to be considered, I think it would be a real shame in terms of science incorporation. And the second issue is that it states applying a systematic review methodology to analyze all the relevant scientific information. So this will be a posteriori, so a review process that will take place after publication of the data. And we think that science peer reviewed should occur before publication and give the control of quality to peers, which is very important in terms of quality of science. The second issue, which I think is very important, is that, well, though some people claim that the proposal does not change the definition, we as scientists feel that the WHO IPCS definition of an EDC is revised in the proposal. And beyond that, the criteria address separately data in humans and non-target organisms. So again, how does it read in the proposal? Endocrine disrupting chemicals with respect to humans shall meet all of the following criteria. Known to cause an adverse effect relevant for human health. 2, as an endocrine mode of action. And 3, the adverse effect is a consequence of the endocrine mode of action. Now, I want to draw to your attention that in the EC roadmap issued in 2014, it was stated known or presumed to cause an adverse effect. And as you may imagine, so the criteria here increased in restriction. And second, if we go to the law back to 2009, it reads that may cause an adverse effect and not that cause an adverse effect. So again, we see that the definition here is restrictive as opposed to the other one. And we made this exercise to oppose somehow the WHO definition with the EC proposal definition. So the WHO definition states an ED, an endocrine disruptor, is an exogenous substance or mixture that alters the function of the endocrine system. So the first issue is altered function. And now it's becoming an ED is an exogenous substance or mixture that has an endocrine mode of action. So there is no longer a focus on function, there is a focus on the mode of action. Second, and causes adverse effect in an intact organism, its progeny or subpopulation, is becoming and is known, so there is a certainty level which is present here, to cause an adverse effect relevant for human health. So I think that's quite a difference with the WHO definition. And finally, the constituently that originally present the adverse effect as a consequence of altered function is now becoming a consequence of the endocrine mode of action. So again, this definition is centering the process on the mode of action. I'm a pediatric endocrinologist, and I can tell you that all the diseases I see does result from altered function. They do not result from a mode of action. And we can take the example of PCBs. You know, PCBs are banned. PCBs have detrimental effect on IQ. And, well, this is, I think, quite well substantiated. And PCBs have been banned for that reason. So function is altered. Thyroid hormones are presumably involved. But we don't know for sure what is the precise mechanism of alteration in thyroid hormone effect. So if we would look at PCBs along the current definition, they should not be banned because we do not know about the precise mechanism. So we as scientists feel that this could be a matter of concern. The other issue, as we discussed, is how about the animal data? Could we somehow consider that animal data are no longer relevant? And just to take an example of a study published this year from my lab, using bisphenol A, BPA. Just to remind you, the EFSA safe daily dose, or so-called safe daily dose of BPA, is 4 microgram per kilogram per day. And we have exposed newborn rats for 2 weeks to 25 nanograms, so 0.025 micrograms, which means 160 times less. And this dose had not been used to such a low level before. This represents, in fact, half the average exposure of everybody in this audience. And we found that puberty was delayed, and the reason was alteration of a very important neurotransmitter in the brain, which is, in fact, altered in the entire brain. So this is raising the question, is this really irrelevant for human health? Well, I understand rats are not men, but I think we should consider such studies. Because this is a neurotransmitter, should we accept that this is non-endocrine mode of action? So we will disregard that. Though GABA is crucial for brain development. And finally, is human exposure, well, becoming somehow ethical? Because no one would imagine that we would expose humans, though we are all exposed to this kind of dose of BPA. So, I think, well, we as scientists working both in clinic and also in laboratories think that looking at both human data and animal data and also in vitro data is really very important. Third issue, the endocrine mode of action is excluding non-specific secondary consequences. Let me explain that. So it appears, it reads in the proposal, in applying the weight of evidence determination, non-specific secondary consequences shall not be considered. What does this mean? Well, I'll take an example. Pesticides are in fact the most important class of products accounting for endocrine disruption. And we know that many of them have non-specific effects in the liver. And the liver is the place where hormones are metabolized, and also where binding proteins that will determine the fraction of hormone that can act in the cell at the cell level, this is where this happens. So hormone action will be affected, but such chemicals affecting the liver would not be classed as EDCs under the current proposal. So we think that any kind of effect, even if this effect is not considered to be directly related to the endocrine system, but indirectly, any kind of effect should be considered. Now the fourth issue is that the proposal somehow introduces a subtle shift from hazard-based to risk-based approach. And just to read again the proposal, it states an active substance shall only be approved if it is not identified as having endocrine disrupting properties unless the risk to humans from exposure to that active substance is negligible. So somehow it introduces an exception, but we don't know to what level this exception would be an exception. And for those of you who are not familiar with hazard versus risk based management, let me take a comparison which is something trivial: drinking alcohol and then driving your car. Well, the hazard is causing an accident, and drinking alcohol can alter driving capacity and cause an accident. We identify the hazard. We manage the hazard and we say driving is not permitted after drinking alcohol, irrespective of amount. And that's in fact what happens in some EU countries where you are not allowed to drink alcohol and drive. Risk-based regulation means that we assess the risk and we say an accident is a function of alcohol exposure that is reflected in the exhaled air levels. 0.5 grams per liter increases latency to reaction from 1 to 1.5 seconds. Risk-based management is to say driving is safe as long as estimated blood level does not exceed 0.5 grams per liter. So you see how the situation is different between risk-based and hazard-based management. Now let's translate that again in the context of the pesticide and biocide law. And you have here categories of chemicals, mutagens, persistent organic pollutants, carcinogens, reprotoxic, and EDCs. And based on hazard identification, they should not be approved. That's the bottom line. Now there is an exception based on negligible exposure. And if exposure is negligible, some compound, some chemical may still be approved. So what the proposal, the June proposal of EC is introducing is the risk instead of the exposure. And the risk, as you see here, is a function of exposure and dose response. And dose response of a chemical is somehow reintroducing potency. And I have no time to spend on that, but potency is really a huge matter of discussion among endocrine scientists, because it's invalid based on different responses depending on which criteria you will arbitrarily select to calculate potency of a chemical. So if I summarize with this cartoon, well, opposing the pesticide and biocide law and the roadmap to the EC proposal, we were discussing about altered function. We now consider or focus on an endocrine mode of action. We involved chemicals that may or that are presumed to cause adverse effect, and now they should be known to cause adverse effect relevant for human health. So somehow this is adding restriction. It was a consequence of altered function, and now it's meant to be a consequence of a mode of action. And on the top of that, I should say the bottom on the figure, hazard is somehow becoming a possible exception based on risk assessment. And, well, beyond that, because there is no other categories than EDC or non-EDC, there is no place left for the precautionary principle. Because this principle applies to those chemicals that would be suspected and where we really have problems in providing a final proof that indeed they are fully, they could be fully regarded as EDCs. So, and that's my final issue, no place left for suspected EDCs. Of course, this is a problem with the precautionary principle which is in EU Constitution, but we can also, well, we can oppose here that cartoon that I explained to the proposal that is option 3 in the roadmap, and where you see there are 3 categories of EDCs, endocrine active substance, suspected endocrine disruptor, and endocrine disruptor, somehow mirroring for EDCs what is existing for other chemicals such as carcinogens. And of course, this makes sense for screening and evaluation and screening, because it's unlikely that screening will pick up endocrine disruptors or non-endocrine disruptors, because screening is limited. And also regulation might consider those different classes. Now, what EC wrote in the communication document is categorization for pesticides and biocides would decrease legal certainty for regulators and stakeholders. Well, we wonder whether legal certainty should not be obtained by defining the legal outcome of the different categories, making law consistent with science. You will never find a publication where the conclusion is this is an EDC, this is not an EDC. The conclusion will be we found that this chemical was consistent with this and that properties. So, because that's the way scientists work in this arena. Now, my final slide, why is categorization of EDCs based on the weight of evidence scientifically indispensable beyond the precautionary principle that we discussed already? Well, almost all the disorders involving EDCs have a probability of causation by EDCs that will never reach 100%. Why? But because other factors are involved, genetics, other, well, think about obesity and diabetes. It's clear that lifestyle is diet, exercise are playing a major role. Second, high throughput regulatory screening for EDC properties, they are more likely to suspect than identify an EDC. And so we think that this is a second reason to involve those suspected EDC category in the law. And second, if there is no category, if there is no suspected EDC category, any compound with insufficient weight of evidence will be classified as non-EDC, which is a real burden for health if they indeed can be endocrine disrupting chemicals. So, just I have this sentence as a conclusion, and I thought to myself that in this arena, stakeholders who are policymakers go from regulation to science, which makes sense for you. I mean, that's your business. My business is to go from science to regulation. And I think it's just like making a tunnel, and we should somehow find a connection so that what science can put in and what you regulatory people should bring in, well, can meet together and really benefit from those two approaches. For those who are interested at this email address, we would be pleased to make the PowerPoint and a text that is describing the PowerPoint available, so please take note of that and send an email with the subject heading EDC, EUP, and you will receive this information. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor. Before I will pass Angeliki to introduce the next speaker, I would like to welcome among us Mr. Ladislav Mikko, Deputy Director General of DG Santa, and I think that in the discussion his contribution will be huge and it's impressive. Welcome, Gisela. And Angeliki, would you like to?
If there are any questions for clarification, you can ask now, otherwise we're going to have the discussion at the end. It has been working as a legal expert on chemicals and pesticides for over 10 years, advising government, NGOs, and the private sector.
Okay, I hope we solve now the issue. So, thank you to Mr. Potts for organizing this event, and it was great to hear the previous speakers. What I will do is to give a bit of a legal perspective on the issue of EDCs, although a lot of things have been mentioned by Mr. Potts, and also we see that scientists are catching up very well with law, so I will try not to go into too many details where issues have been picked up, but I will try to give hopefully an interesting perspective on the legal side of the EDC. So I work for an NGO, so an environmental NGO like I am biased. I am biased towards the protection of human health and the environment. So this is my conflict of interest. And my NGO Client Earth is mainly made of we're mainly lawyers. So we try to support other NGOs and to bring campaigns that are more relevant for the law. So what? Looking at the law, we were asking ourselves: does the EU care about endocrine disruption? Because in this saga of about endocrine disruptions, we've seen a lot of industry scientists a bit, and even looking at the proposal from the Commission, it seems that it's not really important, that this concern has been downplayed. However, if we look at EU policy lawmaking in the last 16 years, we've seen that this concern about endocrine disruption has been ongoing for 20 years, and it has been reflected in many regulatory instruments, from the Water Framework Directive to REACH, cosmetics, plant protection products, biocide, the seventh environmental action products, and recently the regulation on medical devices. So all these documents listed here, all these instruments have been voted in a co-decision procedure, meaning that Parliament, Commission and Council have been involved. This is the core of the democratic process. So, and if we look at the years in which these have been approved, it means that there has been a consistent concern by our decision makers on this issue, which should not be taken aside. So the level of protection should be kept high. We have heard a lot, we hear often about hazard-based and risk-based approach. And as a lawyer, I have a bit of a problem with how this discussion is framed. And taking from the communication of the Commission, I would really be interested in knowing who has written this part that makes a comparison the hazard and the risk between a lion in a cage or a lion and a lion in a cage. I thought that Professor Bourguignon gave a really good example of with the alcohol and driving. The fact is that in the EU, chemicals, unlike what is said in the communication, are never regulated on the basis only of their health. They're always risk consideration. There's a commission document that came out from the same commission, but which describes it better. I don't want you to look too much at and read it. But the difference between the risk management options when we regulate chemicals is between a generic risk assessment and a specific risk assessment. And we can go back to the example of Professor Bourguignon. You can create limits of alcohol intake when based on the probability of an accident or of your response when you take alcohol, or you can just say, well, we identify the hazard, and we say, well, on the basis of that hazard, we have a high level of protection. We don't allow anyone to drive. That's a high protective approach, and that's how it happens with chemicals in some cases, and that's the case of the biocide and the pesticide regulation. They're never regulated on the basis of hazard only. There's always a risk consideration, and the risk consideration is that these chemicals, pesticides, end up in food. We cannot control the exposure of children, of vulnerable population. That's why we regulate, that's risk management, on the basis of their hazard. So the high level of protection, and here we start to go a bit into our legal opinion about the criteria issued by the Commission. Both the biocides and the pesticide regulation aim at ensuring a high level of protection for human health and the environment, and both are underpinned by the precautionary principle. Therefore, this should be reflected in the criteria. Moreover, the high level of protection and the precautionary principle are in our founding document of the EU, the Lisbon Treaty. So it has even stronger legal strength and not only moral, ethical, or policy strength. So we, with the help of lawyers and professor from University of Darmstadt, we asked them to look at the proposal of the Commission. Actually, we asked them even before and to evaluate the four options that they had put in the EDC roadmap for their impact assessment, and to see which of these criteria would be legal and to assess also on the basis of those criteria the proposal that came out from the Commission. Well, the main findings relevant to the criteria is that the scientific criteria need to be based solely on hazard identification. So exposure consideration in the identification of the criteria is not relevant at this stage. And I think this is quite a central point, is the fact that it's pretty consistent both in the two regulatory instruments, biocides and pesticides, but also if we look beyond that, how endocrine disruptors are mentioned or regulated, is that there's pretty much an equal level of concern of our decision makers when they adopt laws between CMRs, carcinogen, mutagens, and toxic for reproduction, and endocrine disruptors. Therefore, the approval mechanism for these two under the biocide and the pesticide regulation should be the same, and they should be based on the precautionary principle. So these findings against the regulation proposed, the criteria proposed by the Commission, if we look at that, we can say, as potency was excluded at the last minute, I understand, by the impact assessment, by the regulatory scrutiny board, that in the view of the of our colleagues that looked at the criteria, their first assessment was that in all likelihood they are based only on scientific consideration and they are based on hazard identification. I put a little star there looking at point 2.3.A.3 of the proposal because when some scientists had looked at it, they highlighted how this specific point, relating to looking at the environment and population effect is a risk-based criteria, and therefore, for what it's worth, from a legal point of view, any risk-based criteria should be considered illegal. Looking at the mandate given to the commission, and this comment was not made by me, it was not made by an NGO, but it was made by an EU institution that came from the European Chemical Agency, so hopefully a reliable source. As for the equivalent level of concern, if we look at and analyze the two regulations, as I said, we see that the same mechanism for approving of CMRs or for excluding CMRs or for granting derogation is given both to EDC and CMRs. So it's not very clear why the Commission, in its proposal, decided that EDC need a higher or incredibly high burden to prove that they are endocrine disruptors. Therefore, I would suggest that the Commission probably exceeded its power creating a difference in these two in the approval process for these two categories of substances, which are clearly of equivalent concern for these two instruments especially. And obviously we go, and this has been said already, so I'm not going to repeat it too much, to the issue of missing, I don't know, by mistake or not, the word presumed from the criteria. As Mr. Potts pointed out at the beginning, if we look at the category of mutagens, and there are several hundreds, there is not a single mutagen that is categorized as a mutagen on the basis of being a known mutagen, but they're always presumed because it's very difficult to have the scientific certainty that we seem to be looking for endocrine disrupting chemicals. Finally, I would like to look at the approval mechanism, and here going back of this shift that has been mentioned by Professor Bourguignon, going back from a risk management based on a hazard identification to a risk management based on a specific risk assessment. And here we're talking about the negligible exposure to negligible risk, which to many people may seem like a very small change. Well, of course, I mean, if the risk is very, very small, why should we be worried? But the mechanism that is implied, it means that for every single chemical we will do a risk assessment, and then we will decide on the basis of that risk assessment that if the risk is very small, then we will allow it. Who will decide what is negligible? Who decides how small is small? Is it a scientist? Or is it a political decision? Or is it a policy decision to decide how much of exposure, how much of risk we should be allowed for European citizens and the environment? And here I leave it for you to, we highlighted in the original text some main issues that have disappeared, like the main cause, adverse effect, negligible, excluding contact with humans, so how the original text of the pesticide regulation had qualified what negligible meant, while the Commission proposal goes back to certainty of having endocrine disrupting properties, talks about negligible risk, and says only in particular where the product is used in a closed system, basically opening to many other ways. So I also would like to draw the attention, as this has not been done, on the reason why it said in the commission document that this change was made, and that is based on technical knowledge. So basically they referred to the fact that EFSA, in an EFSA opinion, said that endocrine disruptors may undergo, as any other substance, a risk assessment. Thank you very much. This happens all the time, and it happens also for CMRs. So hopefully, if we find out, if EFSA tells the commission that also CMRs are subject, can be subject to a risk assessment, which happens every single day, I hope they don't decide to grant derogation on the basis of negligible risk also to CMRs. So I find this particular concern. So the conclusion of the legal assessment done by our colleagues in the University of Darmstadt is that, as others have pointed out, is that the commission proposal exceeds its powers because it changes essential elements of the regulation. This is very clear for the biocide regulation because it contradicts the body of the text, Article 5 of the regulation, but it's as well clear in the pesticide regulation. And it ignores the fact that CMRs and endocrine disrupting substances have an equivalent level of concern. Moreover, I would say, based on what we have been hearing officially, or mainly unofficially, that these criteria may possibly not identify one single substance, then we ask ourselves, well, why going through the trouble of having this if this is not going to protect at all human health and the environment? And it's so my conclusion is that probably this it's not only wrong from a protection level, but also from a legal perspective. And if it's not changed, somebody should do something in order to stop this proposal to go further. Thank you very much.
Swedish Ministry for Environment and Energy, and Maria Wallin, who is the head of section of the Chemicals Unit of the Swedish Ministry for the Environment and Energy. They have both worked with chemical legislation for 10 years at the ministry, as well as the Swedish Chemical Agency.
Thank you very much. Thanks for organizing this meeting, and also thanks for inviting us. And I have to apologize for my voice. I hope you're able to hear me. So, as you can see, we're from the Ministry of Environment and not from KEMI, which is the government agency. So let's start.
We're here to talk about the Swedish concerns and the EDC criteria proposal. I don't know. How do I do? As you know, Sweden brought a court. Sweden brought the Commission to court 2 years ago for failing to adopt a delegated act with criteria to identify endocrine disruptors. We won that court case, and the judgment was delivered in December last year. And ever since that, Sweden has continued to put pressure on the Commission to act. And you may ask yourself, why does Sweden care so much about this? The answer lies partly in the system of environmental quality objectives that the Swedish Parliament adopted years ago, there are 16 environmental quality objectives, and one of them is non-toxic environment. There are milestone targets under each of these environmental quality objectives, and these targets define the steps we have to take in order to reach the long-term environmental objectives. One important milestone target under non-toxic environment is that we have to reduce children's exposure to hazardous chemicals, the most hazardous ones, like the cancerogenic substances, substances that are toxic to reproduction and endocrine disruptors. And of course, we need criteria to identify which substances are endocrine disrupting in order to protect our children. And we need these criteria to be based on the precautionary principle and on science. The precautionary principle aims, as you know, at ensuring a high level of protection for human health and environment through preventive decision taking when there is a risk. So it's a strategy to cope with possible risks where our scientific understanding is yet incomplete. The provisions in the biocides regulation and the pesticides regulations are underpinned by the precautionary principle. It is explicitly stated in the first article of both regulations.
Yes, and the precautionary principle is particularly pronounced in the cutoff criteria that is present in both Langstedt-Stey Acts. And as the previous speakers have already said, these rules mean that that substance which has a certain intrinsic property, be it carcinogenic or having endocrine disruptive properties, it cannot as a rule be approved as a biocide or a PPP. And this ban is based on hazard and not risk. As you can see from the text, it states that the endocrine disruptive properties may cause adverse effects both in the pesticides regulation and the biocides regulation. Yes, and this corresponds, oh, sorry for that slide. This corresponds to the WHO definition of EDGs, which says that it's twofold. It targets both endocrine disruptors, which alter the functions of the endocrine system, and potential endocrine disruptors that I'm so sorry, might be expected to lead to endocrine disruption.
The Commission has stated that they have based the proposal on the WHO definition, but as Professor Perkinjohn pointed out earlier, this is not the case. Because what the criteria actually says is that in order for a substance to be identified as an endocrine disruptor, the substance must be known to cause an adverse effect relevant for human health. And it must be established that this substance has an endocrine mode of action, and the adverse effect relevant for human health must be a consequence of the endocrine mode of action. So let's have a closer look at known to cause an adverse effect relevant for human health. What does this really mean?
It really means that it has to be proved that the effect arising from exposure to a certain substance leads to effects in humans. And as pointed out before, this is not consistent with the rules for CMRs, for which can be regulated both on basis of proof of cancer in humans, for example, but also on suspicion. I'm so sorry for my voice. And also this rules of use of animal studies, which is basically the base for toxicology, regulatory toxicology. It also means that we don't have the opportunity to act until there is proof of harm. And for these substances, it could take decades, because if you're exposed to substance in the womb or in early childhood, this might just not manifest itself until adulthood, maybe 30 years later. And then it would be really hard to make a link from getting diabetes or cancer and exposure in the womb. It's really, really hard. And as you all know, we're exposed to thousands of chemicals throughout our lives. So, is this precautionary in line with the precautionary principle? We think not. And we also wonder what happened to May. May cause adverse effects, because that is what the that is the words that was chosen by the legislators. Substances that may cause an adverse effect should fall for the cutoff rule. So what we believe is that the Commission, by requiring proof of an adverse effect, is actually narrowing down the cutoff rules in the biocides regulation and in the pesticides regulation, because substances that may cause an adverse effect will fall outside the cutoff criteria. We don't think that the Commission has the mandate to do that. If presumed is added to this criteria, known or presumed to cause an adverse effect relevant for human health, we think that the criteria would correspond better to the legislator's intent and the cutoff rules. But we also have a problem with it, the criteria. It has an endocrine mode of action.
Yeah, and this was very well explained by Professor Bobby. Yes, and the thing is, we need to know the mechanism, the biological mechanism behind the effect, and that's really, really, really hard. And I don't know if we have any of that information today, and I think that we need to be humble enough to admit that the level of knowledge today isn't there yet.
So we don't think that this is in line with the precautionary principle, and we also wonder if this is consistent with the wording may cause, substances that may cause an adverse effect. I think that this requirement will lead to that substances that may cause an adverse effect will fall outside the cutoff rule. By adding the word plausible, has a clear or plausible endocrine mode of action, we would be closer to legislative intent and the precautionary rules.
Yes, and we have another problem. Regarding the derogation in the pesticides regulation. As already explained, there's a shift from hazard approach to a risk approach. And yes, this is explained why we have a problem.
We believe that this is an essential element of the annexes. It's the hazard-based approach was a deliberate choice by the legislators. And as the European Parliament Legal Service has pointed out, this amendment is outside, beyond the scope of the Commission's implementing powers. The Commission cannot amend essential elements of the annexes or the regulation. This is reserved to the legislatures. So we don't think that the Commission can actually do this amendment. So we have many concerns with the criteria, but these are the main ones. We believe that in order for the criteria to be workable and in line with the precautionary principle, it must be enough that an endocrine mode of action is plausible. We also think that the Commission, by requiring proof of an endocrine mode of action, is changing the scope of the cutoff rules. The cutoff rule is put in the body of the biocides regulation in Article 5 and is an essential element of the annexes to the pesticides legislation, and the Commission has no mandate to change this. We also think that the shift from a hazard-based approach to a risk-based approach in the derogation clause in the pesticides regulation is beyond the scope of the Commission's implementing powers. And if these criteria are to be adopted, they will not lead to a non-toxic environment, and they will not help us to reduce children from being exposed to endocrine disrupting substances, because hardly any substances will be considered as endocrine disruptors. So we will not be able to protect our children and reach the milestone targets and the non-toxic environment. And we also think that the Commission, it's extremely important that the Commission acts within its mandate. Because what the legislator asked the Commission to do
is to adopt, propose and adopt a delegated act with scientific criteria to make the cutoff rules work. That's the only thing that the legislator asked of the Commission. But the Commission has done more than that. It tries to change the cutoff rules, and it changes an essential element of the delegation clause, which is from a risk-based approach to a risk-based approach. This is outside a mandate of the Commission. So we think this is a matter of democratic legitimacy, and that's also why Sweden takes committed to this subject. Thank you.
Thank you so much, and I see that your minister of environment is right. Good for her. Thank you to all the distinguished speakers. I would like now start the discussion. Of course, I suppose everybody who wants to ask or make a comment will introduce yourself. And remember, we are here not to dispute this commission. We are here to ask the experts some questions, maybe ask the Swedish delegation, if I may, about the opinion of Sweden, the leader of the member states in this issue. But I think you are not anymore alone. If I have 15 member states are against this proposal, and I must say, if I would go with the legal service of the European Parliament, we are also almost there. So, yeah, please.
Thank you. Lisette Van Vliet from Health and Environment Alliance. I had a question for the Swedish Ministry of Fisheries. I believe that in 2008, Sweden did an estimate of how many substances would get captured under the then proposal of the pesticides regulation. Now that you have seen the current proposal for the scientific criteria, do you also have an estimate? You said a few substances or almost no substances. Do you have, can you specify that more concretely? Because as Vito Buonsante said, we have heard that the European Chemicals Agency and the European Food Safety Authority have estimated that under the current proposal, zero substances would actually qualify. So I'm curious to know if you have a concrete estimate. Thank you.
Thank you very much. No, we don't have a concrete estimate, but I think the estimate from ECHA would be quite accurate.
Okay, I'll just stop.
Maybe I should react at least in this moment. Anyway, good afternoon, and thank you for the invitation. And I find this discussion first extremely important, second very useful. And you would not be surprised that there are some issues which were said where I will disagree with what was said. And the first one which I would strongly disagree is that anyone from the agencies ever said that under the present conditions it will be zero substances which will pass through. We actually made some estimates. I can say, I mean, because this is preliminary, you need to go through the detailed assessment, obviously. But it is somewhere around, at least what we are aware, about 30 substances which we know that will most probably fall in. So please don't speak about zero. And with that, I also, if I may say so, I would strongly disagree that the proposal fails to protect human health. Because even if we, theoretically speaking, excluded one endocrine disruptor from the environment, we already contributed to better health. So, I mean, this is statements which are a little bit dehonesting all the work around that. Now, I see the scientific comments, and I take them very seriously, and there are many issues we would like and could discuss. But I would really probably start with saying that it is useful to read the mandate and also the existing legislation in its entirety, not just speak about one article or another article. That though is true for the proposal. For example, the discussion about known effect versus may cause. You may, if you just take this one simple sentence, interpret it in a way as you say. I agree. But if you see the following articles, you will come very clearly to conclusion why then we speak about the results of the animals, of the in vitro cases, etc., etc. If that was excluded, this part of proposal would be then not needed. It is there because when we speak, it's known to have effect which is relevant for human health. It is in relation to existing information from all these sources. So we can speak about that if the word known is the best possible word in this place. But certainly it doesn't mean that we are speaking about proven impact on concrete human cases. This is not true. This is not in the proposal. And I want to dissolve this worry because it's not true, simply. So this is one, just one from the things. The second is the risk-based versus hazard-based. And I like the example of alcohol, I have to say. Because it illustrates quite well the thing. First of all, if I may disagree, you said that there is always risk-based involved in the assessment of the chemicals in the European legislation. And then in the second slide, you said that we have CMR cutoff, which is hazard-based, right?
Not the risk management.
So we speak about things, I mean, as it is useful for discussion, fine. It's good to challenge. But we have cutoff criteria for carcinogens, mutagens, and the reproductive. We have risk assessment for all other toxic effects. And why we speak here about the endocrine disruptors is that we realized in the past, in the 16 years of development, that beyond that effects, beyond carcinogenicity, beyond mutagenicity, beyond reprotoxic effects, and beyond the general toxicity, whatever you call it, it may be some other effect which is linked to the endocrine mode of action, which is not addressed yet in our legislation. Therefore, we introduce the additional criterion, which is the endocrine mode. It doesn't mean that if the substance is not proven direct link between the endocrine mode of action and its effect, if the effect is harmful, it will be catched by the system because of the other legislation which is in place. So please, don't tell like, I mean, if it is carcinogenic and we don't prove that it is endocrine mode of action, it will be allowed. It will not be allowed, obviously not, because cancerogenic substances are cut off out of the system already now. So that should be very clearly said. Please make that very clear. Where are the gaps? And we can discuss about that. Okay, no problem. On top of it, even in this case, we say if the endocrine mode of action is proved, it is cut off, it is not going to be approved. Where the shift is, which you mentioned, is in exemptions, which are under very strict regime. And you said, I don't know who of you, but I think it was repeated several times, who is going to assess what is negligible? Okay, what is the alternative? We are speaking about two possible terms. One is negligible exposure, and the second is negligible risk. In both cases, you will have to assess what is negligible. In both cases, someone will have to decide why for one case it is okay and for another it is not. It will be the body which is responsible for that, which is a committee with the member states' representatives, which will be assessing that and voting about that. For me and for us, I mean, fortunately I had some experience, not much, but 10 years of science. And I can tell you that we can discuss endlessly what is more specific in terms of negligible exposure or negligible risk. I see the point why it is raised so often, because there is a fear that negligible exposure will be potentially, in terms of number of molecules in the environment, higher than negligible risk. This is an assumption, but it could be also other way around, you agree. We could have a very, very low exposure, which still will have not negligible risk. So, I mean, it works on the both sides. And it is about how it is going to be implemented. And from our analysis, what comes very clearly out, and I think this is one element which I would like really very seriously mention here. We have to provide the legislation which is not only trying to be as protective to human health, etc., what is the goal, as possible, but which is also controllable and implementable. And we have been looking on the issues, for example, how you will then assess the court cases when one member state will say negligible exposure is 20 milligrams, another will say 27, and third will say 175. Because it is exposure and not about the effect, you have no actually catch how to decide who is right. While if you speak about the risk, this is clear, it is either causing an effect or not, based on the scientific literature. So then, if I can say it should be negligible risk, I have much better answer, if you wish, for implementation, for enforcement. So this is behind. We have been thinking about not only writing nice things into legislation, but also be able to check it afterwards, and be able also to say you are not implementing properly, because this is also our role. We should not create unimplementable legislation. Now, the third problem, which I understand, again, very well, is the categories, okay? Suspected versus proven. I would say that certainly it is understandable that the people would be nervous if the first category is empty, then it's useful to have at least the second. I can tell you that first category, which is proven it is not empty. But now, it was mentioned here and questioned, and it was a very, very difficult internal discussion in terms of really, again, reading what the text would deliver, if we put it there, this or that way. And we are setting up the clear criteria for, actually in all the legislation we have, what it is, if it is endocrine disruptor. We don't have any legal framework for the suspected ones. So that would mean redo all the legislation to have a legal consequence. Otherwise it is empty statement which will indeed, and I insist, not to contribute to legal certainty at the present moment. You will have something what has no legal consequence. It will only create all kind of fears and debates and disputes about should it or should it not be. What I think, I mean, the real effect, which will be on the suspected substances, if they were in a category, it would be that it triggers more, I assume, research or intensity of looking at is it then qualifying or not. But I think this is per se, by the way, the very fact, what we see here in this room, that you order 35 places and you need 70 shows, that I cannot imagine that some substance which will come out from EFSA assessment as a substance which have been eventually seen as a potential endocrine disrupting substance, and EFSA will say, we are not able on the basis of the existing evidence to decide. I cannot imagine that this is not going to trigger what is a desired effect of putting in on a separate list. So I am convinced that that would be ensured anyway. I mean, we can discuss about to have a legal option to push for it versus just leave it for the demand of the society, I agree. But without having a clearly defined legal consequence of having this category of substances, this will be just empty statement which will only cause problem in the legal system rather than help. So it doesn't mean if in the course of the next action, member states and Parliament and others will decide that that would be useful, and we have to go and we have your long list of the legislation, amend everything, to have also a kind of explanation how this applies for the potential, suspected, whatever, I mean, category, I don't want to go to details. I mean, I don't see any reason why that should not be done, but that must be really first in the basic legislation. We are now reflecting the existing one, which is requiring definition what is and what is not endocrine disruptor, not what could be endocrine disruptor. This is not our mandate. I know that it came from discussion, and we are aware of the potential, let's say, positive triggers which it could make, but it doesn't change that our goal was for the two directives to define what is endocrine disruptor. Now, I don't know if I didn't forget some of the issues, but I think in discussion I can react further. But I really think that for somehow I have a figure. Sorry, one thing. We exceeded our powers. That's also something that I should comment. We are actually, and more and more over the time, very careful about assessing if we are not exceeding our powers. So I only can tell you that this issue was in detail and very detailed analysis checked with our legal service. And according to our legal service, this is not the right statement. We didn't exceed our powers. Now we can have a different view of, sorry, not, I mean, I am not a legal service. Our legal service may have different view than legal service of Parliament or some of the member states. That's for the further discussion, I'm sure. But I just want to demonstrate something else. We care about that. We ask first if this is okay or not, and only if we have reassurance that we can do it, only then we propose it. That the view on that may be different, that's another story.
Yes, so thank you, Lisa. I've tried, you know, to prevent you to be stoned, but because you are a very brave member of the commission and friend of mine, so I tried to save your life. Now, Jean-Pierre, you wanted to comment?
Yes, please. Well, thank you, Mr. Vico, for, I think, quite constructive comments and approach. Maybe three further comments. Well, you said, and I'm glad to hear that, that human case proof somehow is not absolutely required. Then, what was the reason to have two separate regulations? One for, well, there is a regulation which is relevant for human situation, and then for other living organisms, am I correct? There are two... what do you say, non-target. So, if I can just go, well, that's a question I have. The second... The second comment, back to the mode of action, you say, well, this is, and that's how you said it, an additional criteria. And of course, then it could be seen that this is somehow providing enrichment of the criteria, providing a supplementary criteria. Well, my understanding, but I may misunderstand, it's that this is an initial and central criteria instead of an additional criteria. And just to make an example, well, DES, so this dramatic diethylstilbestrol story, which in fact started with 6 case observation. No one did know about the mechanism, the mode of action. There was just a relation between exposure to this chemical and a cancer decades later. And somehow, this is nowadays that we realize, because this is a transgenerational issue, that epigenetics is probably one key mechanism. So I'm just very concerned that starting with the mode of action as the main focus may somehow bypass other information and delay by decades decision about chemicals. And maybe a final comment about the criteria for suspected versus overt EDC. Well, I do not think the criteria are different. What is different is the weight of evidence. And we certainly do not deal with a black and white issue. We all should know that. So what about the gray situation? How are we going to manage that? Thank you.
Yes, and I would call to Riton's comment as well.
Thank you. Thank you for your replies. Of course, you may continue to disagree, but I just wanted to clarify a couple of things. On the issue of changing risk, negligible risk, negligible exposure to negligible risk, you're saying that probably it may happen, that it gives more legal certainty, and it may happen that a negligible exposure may be more dangerous than a negligible risk. I still would continue to agree with our legal opinion and with the Parliament's opinion that this was not in the limit of the Commission to change, because it's you're changing the way in which the co-decision legislator has decided to look at the risk management options, the consequences from the identification, and therefore it's like the balance of power may have been, you're grabbing a bit the power that of a decision that was taken by the Parliament and the Council. But the other issue where I would continue to disagree is that the fact that what the negligible exposure is in the legislation is quite clearly defined. It basically says no contacts with humans. I really don't see how a situation where most of the times there's no contacts with humans or closed system, like, you may give me one example or two, and you may do it. You may be able to do it. You probably thought about it to respond to this criticism. But in the bigger picture, I see that very unlikely, because negligible risk can mean using a substance in 1 million tons. It's just I'm exaggerating, but it can mean a million tons. But you just say, well, this is a threshold chemical. The exposure is kept under that threshold, and therefore there's no risk, not even negligible. You can say there's no risk because this is how we do in the regulatory fiction of a risk assessment. An answer on the categories. I did not in my speech talk so much about categories, because I did touch upon the presumed, because here we're talking about hazard identification. And when we do hazard identification in the EU, we usually refer to the CLP, to the CLP, and that's how we do. We take presumed. But categories are relevant in existing legislation. That's cosmetics, where category 2 CMRs are not allowed, and therefore category 2 EDCs, if we say that there's equivalent level of concern, would have consequences. And we can think also of the water framework directly.
Yeah, it would be very, 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 very nice mud fight to hear just shooting from these two sides. No, Susan, short remark, then I will give the floor to Ladislav to answer, but and then the questions from the auditory. Yeah?
I have one short comment, and the criteria we're discussing today will be interpreted against the existing classification rules in the CLP regulation. And known to have an adverse effect in humans equals category 1A in CLP, and that means that human data is required. And at the comitology meeting last week, the Commission explained that by known to cause an adverse effect, they actually mean presumed to have an adverse effect. And I think, as a lawyer, I would strongly advise you to write down what you mean.
Very nice. Well, it's off. 30 seconds for answer.
I will really try to be sure, because I'm also curious about other questions and comments, obviously, and this is the purpose of the meeting. This is for long discussion. Nevertheless, known to cause effect to humans is not the same as known to have effects relevant for human health. I mean, this is legally speaking something else. We are not speaking about the direct effect on humans, but on the effects which may be relevant for humans, and further in text is explained what this relevant means. This partly answers also your first comment, okay? So, the word relevant for human health make this relation to other cases which are not the direct human cases, in fact. Please, don't forget about this word. Regarding negligible risk and effect, and legislator has decided this one, I have to comment. This is the favorable area of discussion between institutions, so I am not going to enter into it, okay? But there is an unwritten understanding that if the legislator wants to fix something which should be subject to change only if there is agreement of all who are in the legislature, then it is put in the main text of legislation. This one is in annex where the Commission has a power given by legislator to change the annex. So just procedurally speaking, we have right to change that annex given by legislator, and that's why, that's one of the reasons why our legal service believes that we are entitled to make this change. Not only one, because that would be only procedural, but please, I mean, this is the status how it is today explained. And this is, I think, the address. Delay by mistakes. I am worried about that. But I don't think that what we are discussing here today will change anything. We either have an evidence on cancerogenity, on endocrine disrupting property, or whatever, or we don't. If we have it, it will fall in one of the categories. If we don't have it, no matter if it is endocrine mode or cancerogenity per se or whatever, we will have until these delayed effects. Unfortunately, I'm not happy about that. But in the impact assessment, the only thing which will come out, I suspect, from the EFSA or ECHA would be there is a proof of effect or not. And as a risk manager, I cannot work with the suspect, or we need to. It will be simply then said, we don't have enough evidence, therefore the other principles, including the precautionary principle, apply. So, you know, this is for me very difficult. I don't see how the change which you mentioned, that in the legislation on endocrine disruptors, we will not say that we are looking on endocrine modifications. So what is the logic of the legislation on endocrine disrupting substances if we don't say that the endocrine mode of action is what we are addressing? I don't catch that.
I think you will get it later. Now, quick questions from Oliver. I've seen you, and introduce yourself, please.
I'm Martin Dermin from Pan Europe. Thank you to DG Santé for being present. I have two questions. One, when you say that we need legal certainty and that the may cause would not lead to legal certainty, I don't understand why may cause would just not include the ones for which we know that they cause and the ones that are suspected. I don't understand. I mean, it can be scientifically defined. So it can be legally, it can be a legal requirement for which I think Commission could not be attacked before court. And the second was more a remark. You said that carcinogens would be anyway identified by the current way of evaluation. I think for that, maybe you trust a bit too much our system of identification of carcinogens. We know that farmers who work, or workers who work in vineyards and bystanders in these areas where a large amount of pesticides are used, are more susceptible to having cancers then farmers who worked in other areas like dairy farms and so on, so they use pesticides that are not classified as carcinogens, but we know that there is an alteration of the endocrine function because they have cancers that are linked to the endocrine system. So for this, I think that using the may cause would help us to have a more perfect system that would also catch these carcinogens for which the current system of identification is not perfect enough.
Very good. Who on the right? Because questions are on the speakers. Or it was another stone to the commission? Or what? You know, I
I don't think it is a stone, it's a relevant
question. Very nice. So who wants to answer?
I can only agree on the fact that there's no problem of legal certainty. I mean, if you say that you want to protect citizens also from suspect, I'm addressing what Martin said, from presumed or suspected or somebody told me that it may be, then you create the legal certainty. Then it's a choice. I mean, it's a choice, and what we are, our reaction is the fact that the choice made in for the endocrine disruptors is a higher burden of proof.
There is a question, very short reaction. I checked really carefully my minutes, what I said. I didn't say tonight that known or made cause was because of the legal certainty. And the legal certainty I use in the discussion about the risk-based and okay. Here I was trying to explain that our text, in consequence, have the same or very, very, very similar meaning as may cause. And as we see how important this simple word, despite of the real legal effect, is, I think we already said, I think several times, that we will just reflect. Because this is not a problem for me.
I agree with you. I agree with you that may cause is important for that. But we just claim that what this text now means exactly the same. This is what I'm saying, not that it is something different. Okay?
That's very good to hear that the Commission agrees with us. I've seen that. Yes, you are second, please. Yeah.
Barbara Dominix, I'm also a member of the Endocrine Society and part of its task force. I want to rather insist upon what Jean-Pierre has already mentioned, the fact that a number of secondary effects are going to be excluded in the current criteria. It specifically says that there has to be an endocrine mode of action and it's not a secondary consequence of other physiological effects. Now this, of course, is very problematic because so many substances, particularly pesticides, will increase, as Jean-Pierre said, hepatic metabolism and thereby decrease hormonal levels. If this occurs in an adult, it may be less damaging than if it occurs in a pregnant woman. If it occurs in a pregnant woman, you're going to have reduction of thyroid hormone availability. We all know about the need for thyroid hormone for optimal brain development. And so this idea of excluding chemicals that act through a secondary level of physiology is exceedingly dangerous and needs to be reconsidered.
Thank you, and I think we can collect the next question too.
I'm assistant of MEP Anja Hazekamp from Google and Health. She's been working on the subject. You just said the information that probably 30 substances might get banned on the proposal from the Commission. So I wanted to ask the experts how many substances, endocrine disrupting substances, that may have effects on human health are there? And is it sufficient to take 30 off the market to protect human health? What's your opinion on that?
Yeah, fine. Thank you. Finally, a real question. Please, our experts, can you answer?
Well, you know, the number of chemicals put in the environment by industry is about
100,000, whether you look at ECHA or EPA databases. Out of that, we know, if we look at peer-reviewed literature, and here there is a huge problem, because all the data from the regulatory files escape the public domain. We don't know about those data. But from what we know from the public peer-reviewed literature, there is about, and this has been reviewed by the Endocrine Disruptor Exchange, there is about 1,000, a little more than 1,000 chemical, where studies question possible endocrine disrupting properties. And beyond that, you may go to the JRC study, which is about half of that, because they also selected chemicals, well, presumably or possibly causing endocrine disruption. So this gives you a figure.
Mm-hmm. So we take 30 out of 1,000 will be banned. So 970. That's just what I'm about.
Yeah, sure.
You're mixing several things, sorry. We are speaking about the substances which are potentially used as active substances of pesticides or biocides. 1,000 is all chemicals around us, including your smoked bacon, okay? Also with this kind of action eventually, okay? So we are speaking about what was our task, define the criteria for endocrine disruption for the two legislations, pesticides and biocides. And on top of it, when we speak about the number of substances there, don't forget that we also have to speak about the use and about the volumes. And if we take away, I will not mention the bloody substance, which is 50% of all pesticides eventually, we make bigger effect as if we delete 500 substances, which will altogether mean 1% of the use. So this is not that simple as it looks like, okay? So 30 substances are the substances which we looked because we believe they are broadly used and they may have this effect, so the effect of cutting them out will be significant, will be visible. We couldn't analyze all 1,000 substances in preliminary go for this, because you were all criticizing us for impact assessment taking half a year, but this will take 10 years to do it. So, I mean, be reasonable on the other side.
Very well, I suppose we are reasonable. I've seen the next question, I mean. You, yes.
Thank you, I'm Tony Tudale. I try to enlist the advisors of NGOs. I have a specific question for the Commission. And this may not be an issue, I don't know. The phrase systematic review is follows primarily based on the international methods. So I don't think there's any controversy about systematic review. It means everything and a very specific method of evaluating quality.
Very well, and I question you want to comment?
No, it's just a comment on the numbers. EFSA itself published a report in 2013 on the neurotoxic and the thyroid signaling pathways of 287 pesticides that are on the market, and found that 101 of them had evidence in their dossier, in their files, that they were affecting thyroid hormone signaling. And another 97 were neurotoxic. These are chemicals on the market, and these are chemicals that will not be included in those 30. So we do have a problem with your definition.
Where else? Speakers want comments on this?
Well, maybe just along the same comment. I think, well, though the criteria have been defined in the context of pesticide and biocide law, I think presumably I do not see how other criteria could be used for other chemicals, for endocrine disrupting chemicals. And, well, back to your question, I mean, EPA in the US is putting a high effort at the screening stage with high throughput methods in vitro that would allow to screen a huge number of chemicals. And here again, we are stuck with the same question: what are the criteria? And presumably they should be the same. So I think that's why we have to widen our discussion and our thinking about the criteria. They should apply not only to those specific regulations, but more broadly to the regulatory aspects of EDCs.
Wonderful, thank you. I've seen it. Two hands. Yours?
So my name's Paul Leonard. I work for BASF. And first of all, I just want to acknowledge this is a challenging topic from all perspectives.
Can you get to a microphone? I can't hear you very well, please. Thank you.
So Paul Leonard from BASF. Just want to acknowledge this is a challenging topic for all stakeholders. But I actually had a question for Chairman. You opened the conference by explaining that we needed horizontal criteria. And so my question is, how are we going to have horizontal criteria for endocrine disrupting chemicals in sectors, for example, naturally occurring substances in food additives, pharmaceuticals, biocides? How on earth are we going to deal with those substances if there isn't some form of derogation based on risk?
I think it's not so difficult question. I would recommend you to read the ECHA comments on this issue, because in fact we are creating such a criteria. Because whatever we create for these 2 years, we have, for simple reason, used for others. So I would recommend you just read what ECHA says on this. And it is, the criteria in practice will inevitably impact the discussion with another legal framework dealing with endocrine disruptors, such as, for example, REACH, cosmetics, medicinal products, regulations, etc. So what we are proposing now will create, precedent for other legislations. So that's why we need horizontal criteria.
So if I understand you correctly, if there's a pharmaceutical that would be endocrine disruptive, even though it's therapeutic, the implication is it's unacceptable.
Yeah, it's a very tough question, but we tried to address this question in Parliament many times. It's very difficult, yes, but we have to address this. Because I can tell you that some pharmaceuticals can deteriorate even ecosystems, and we have to address this issue. We have to. No, we just can't stay blind to this. It is an issue, you are right.
No, just briefly on this, like, what we're looking at is identification, right? Then every different regulatory instrument has its own way of managing the risk. In the pesticide, there's a cut-off criteria, but in most other legislation, there is no cut-off criteria. Under REACH, you get an authorization. Under cosmetics, there's other ways. And so I don't think the identification is problematic then for various instruments where then we can use keep on using EDC.
Then I have to speak.
Yeah, please.
Because for identification, we have hazard-based criteria. We have only for derogation the risk-based exception. So if the identification is a key, then you should be happy with the proposal. I'm sorry. This is the truth. The exemptions, the derogations, may be based on negligible risk, but identification is based on the hazard of the property. This is the text which is proposed.
Very well. I see probably the last question, because Angeliki wants to make then also some remarks. So please, your question.
Thank you. So I just have one comment before I ask my questions, and I would like to emphasize that what Dr. Miko said about the number of EDCs is correct insofar as this 1,000 number that is being put out by the endocrine exchange system is just those studies that initially show the potential for endocrine property, disrupting property, for those things that have been studied. So actually we have no idea about all those things that haven't been studied. And as we know, scientists in the research realm, with all due respect to Jean-Pierre Bourguignon, who's more in the clinical realm, spend a lot of time reconfirming or contradicting their peers. So they don't often go outside and take up completely new substances. So actually, we have no idea how many EDCs there are. And therefore, what we need to look at is, will we pick up those things that are supposed to be cut off under the pesticides and biocides legislation, and what about all the other legislation that covered the other sectors? So that was my first comment. I have two questions. First of all, if I understand, if I took correctly what you said, you said we don't have clearly defined legal consequences for any category other than definite EDC. Now, I'm confused because when the legislation says may cause adverse effects, I take that to apply not only to definite EDCs, but also suspected EDCs, because in the limits of our knowledge, they could cause, may cause adverse effects. So I see the legislation as saying there are clear legal consequences, the cutoff, minus the derogation calculations, for EDCs and suspected EDCs. And so I don't understand how you say there are no clearly defined legal consequences for suspected EDCs. That's my other question, first question. And my second question goes back to the EDC properties relevant for human health. Out of the CMR practice and the report from the JRC, what has been concluded and accepted for quite some time is that things that are causing adverse effects in animals should always be presumed to be relevant for humans. So I don't understand why we have to go through, except in very exceptional cases where it's clearly not relevant to humans, go through a discussion and a debate about is this relevant for humans or not. It will be the vast minority of cases where it's not relevant, so I don't see why that has to be dealt with in the legislation, in the proposition the way you've put it. Those are my two questions, thank you.
Very nice, and I would like to collect also questions from Angeliki.
I've heard you said that it probably 30 pesticides are going to be banned, even though the word presumed has been deleted. I would like to have a confirmation that you said this, because I understand that the Commission decided to do an impact assessment. They set up a scientific methodology by the JRC, and they identified all the substances that they are presumed and suspected endocrine disruptors or known or active, I don't know if it's the third one. So now I see with this risk, what I understand with the change in this paragraph of the annex is these 30 substances are not going to be banned anymore. Therefore, the exercise of the impact assessment, I don't see how it's being used by the Commission at this moment. Are you going to ban this? This was the second option of the definition. It was the WHO, presumed or known to cause endocrine disruption effect, and that may cause adverse effects. So are there going to be 30 pesticides banned, or with a negligible risk, there are going to be no pesticides banned? Because I also understand the negligible risk. It says also that we have to use the MRL levels. So this is what we do with all the pesticides. So I don't understand, because before it was 0.01, sorry, I'm becoming technical, but it was the default value. That's the one we allow in baby food. But now we go to MRLs. Maybe some people don't understand this, but me reading it, it means that it's not you're not going to ban 30 pesticides. That's my...
Yeah, reactions, please.
You are asking me to make a risk assessment which is to be done by someone else and then consequent decision. I am just telling you that the present criteria will not result in the empty basket, if you wish, if you look on the endocrine disruptors based on this criteria among the pesticides and biocides. I would refrain, if you allow me, to go further than that, simply not because I do believe they will be excluded, but I don't want to be catched at every word I say here in this discussion, which is, in my view, conceptual and not about the concrete substance, this or that. So I am trying to explain what is the logic of our thinking behind this proposal. And I'm trying to convince you that our interest is exactly the same as yours, but we are also factoring in the elements which are the legal part of the story, mandate, the existing legislation, implementability and enforceability. This is what we factored in. We may come, and it will be further discussion, we may come to finding here and there that okay, probably a better formulation would have been more clear, whatever. I'm not denying that. What I'm denying is a bad intention. I have a feeling from all these discussions, I have into so many of them, that basically Commission came with something what is actually aiming to make a harm to our people instead of protecting their health. Opposite is true, we do it first, only one administration in the whole world to protect our people. And it's for me a bit strange, really. I mean, why we are not demonstrating all in United States, China, Brazil, Russia, you can select, where they do nothing. We do first in the planet something. We try to have as good as possible system which will deliver. And we are discussing about that. Is that really the belief of people here that Commission has no interest in the health of the people in the Europe? Is that the starting point of our discussion? So this is what is strange for me. As I said, if you go to the substance, I believe that what we propose is derived from WHO definition as much as possible. I heard the comments here which question that, but it questioned also the WHO definition per se, which is a broader discussion at the global level. So, okay, let's open the discussion. Why not? Okay. And I'm trying to explain that the formulations we use are, in our understanding, fit for the purpose which we have to fulfill. Now, we will have to reflect, of course, what is coming from discussion. This is no discussion. No, of course, question.
Vladislav, thank you so much. I must say that our time is depleted, so your bittersweet answer from the soul of the Commission is maybe the best conclusion we could ever have. I would like to thank my co-chair, Angelika Dismakru from Pan-Europe, Jean-Pierre Bourgnon from the Grand Society, thank you very much. Vito Bonsante from Bandart, and Suzanne Plaston, Maria Wallin from Ministry of Environment and Energy Sweden. Thank you all for being here, and especially I would like to thank Vladislav for coming and for giving us a clear picture about what Commission in reality intended. Thank you all.